Hello and welcome to Science Solutions. We're very privileged today to have Professor Nathan S. Lewis of California Institute of Technology return to our program for, first of all, updating us on his artificial photosynthesis research project involving the Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis and whatever else he wishes to talk about. The theme of this program is affordable alternative energy. And first of all, Nate, I want to welcome you back.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good to have you.
Good to be back.
A little background on Professor Lewis. Actually, we can see more about him by looking at the previous program per the link that's displayed. So I'm going to give a shorter introduction on Dr. Lewis today. Nathan S. Lewis is the Argyros Professor of Chemistry and Alfred P. Sloan Fellow at the California Institute of Technology. Since 1992, he has been principal investigator of the Beckman Institute Molecular Materials Resource Center at Caltech. Now, Nate Lewis, in 2009, was ranked by Rolling Stone magazine as the 17th out of 100 most influential agents of change in America. Professor Lewis is also currently a principal investigator at the Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis, as well as the editor-in-chief of the Royal Society of Chemistry journal, Energy and Environmental Science. He has published over 400 scientific papers and has mentored scores of postdoctoral associates and graduate students. So, Nate, we're just so privileged and we're curious about the progress you have made since you were last on the program on artificial photosynthesis and creating fuel from solar energy. So if you could give us a little bit of a recap of what that's about to start with.
Now, the goals of artificial photosynthesis are that we have to go four for four here. There are four things that you need to be use-inspired and validated. One, it's going to have to be efficient because we're going to trade food for fuel in regular photosynthesis. They're very inefficient. If we can't beat nature at its own game, we're going to have very large land areas, and there isn't enough land to do all the energy we need to do. We've got to be efficient. We've got to be cost-effective. If it can't scale and is something unaffordable and uses very scarce elements like iridium or platinum, there's not enough of those things. We could build it in the lab. We couldn't scale it. It's got to last. It can't be something that you put out and 30 seconds later, after your lab demonstration, the sun goes away and the thing disintegrates or rusts. And it has to be safe. You can't be making explosive mixtures of hydrogen and oxygen and expecting that it goes on somebody's roof or in their backyard. We need to get all four of those things simultaneously. When we started, we had arguably none of those things. Maybe one. Maybe materials that we had that were efficient didn't last, and ones that lasted weren't efficient. So we could have one of the two, but we certainly didn't have a vision for how to get all four at once. Mm-hmm. We're now at the stage where we have three out of the four with a path that we can develop, we think, to get us to all four, which is the trick here. So what's the status and what's the update? Well, I think it probably would be helpful if we walk through a little bit of the background for people that may not want to go back and refer to the last hour show. And to say that, first of all, that we are aided by the fact that we've put a lot more attention into this area that government R&D levels, which it warrants. So my research in this field is supported and is partnered with the Department of Energy through the Joint Center for Artificial Photosynthesis.
And you just got another $75 million, right?
4 or 5 years, should congressional appropriations allow for that. It's year by year, but we make good progress, we should be able to get that. It's focused.
And you said earlier, this is interesting, you said there's not enough land to grow all of these things that we could turn into fuel. So, but your approach doesn't require raising a whole lot of crops. That's the secret. We don't have to grow switchgrass and corn and all these things that have actually been proven inefficient, I guess, economically. You're going to be able to do this without growing, you know, scads of acres of crops.
Exactly. Okay. So those are the five ingredients, the membrane, two catalysts, and two light absorbers in this structure. And that sounds great. When we started this project about a decade ago, we only had that PowerPoint. We had no such materials in order to make the vision a reality.
You didn't even have the strontium titanate.
We didn't have it in this form. We didn't know it could work this way.
Okay.
So we had none of these things. We just had the idea, the gleam in our eye, that this is how we were going to get this airplane off the ground. Mm-hmm. Well, we've come a long way. This is a picture of our showing our ability to actually grow silicon as the bottom cell. We flip it around after we grow it. In what you can see are exactly those forests of photons. We grow microwires by a very simple process. It's a toaster oven, basically.
What am I looking at here? What are these things?
You're looking at single crystals of silicon microfilaments grown off of a silicon substrate. Mm-hmm. We do that by having a catalyst, nickel or copper, like on a printed circuit board, that we just stamp, literally with a rubber stamp, into little regions of this wafer. We put that into a furnace and then pass silicon as a precursor over that. Everywhere there's metal, it grows like corn, these beautiful single crystal pure silicon microwires.
Now, last time when you were here, you said something like, if I put a material that looked like bubble wrap on my roof, that this would make the artificial fuel. Is that what this is? Is this like
this
the
is going to be part
stuff?
Of the material in the bubble wrap, as you'll see.
So you've got a concept now.
So we've got more than a concept.
We've got a working model.
We have a working model. We need the catalysts, and then we also need materials that are stable. Mm-hmm. How do we develop both of those? Well, we've actually developed and discovered entire families of non-precious metal catalysts that we sprinkle down here to evolve hydrogen from water. Mm-hmm. This is important because they're not expensive. Most commercial electrolyzers use platinum or iridium, and they can be done at commercial scale, but you can't do them at energy scale. Mm-hmm. So we had to develop and discover replacements for the platinum, which we've successfully done. We have materials like cobalt phosphide, molybdenum phosphide, entire families of catalysts that we discovered in collaboration with a group at Penn State, Ray Schock's group, literally 2 years ago.
Wow.
This has been a major stepping stone for us. The second major stepping stone is that we needed materials on the top side that were stable. Silicon is stable on the bottom. It can't be reduced any further. It's already elemental silicon. But we don't dare use silicon on the top because that's an oxidizing environment. It would just all turn to sand.
Oh.
A postdoctoral fellow in my research group discovered a way to coat these existing materials with a very thin layer of titanium dioxide, just the same stuff used in sunscreen. This is a special titanium dioxide, though, because it also conducts electricity. It's not insulating. That's what we need, because we have to get the light absorbed that makes this incipient electricity out to the liquid. If we just painted it with garden variety paint, that would be insulating. We would get no fuel. But this TiO2 made in this way is conformal, it can be sprayed or applied anywhere, and it's electrically conductive while optically transparent.
So you made it work.
So we made it work.
Okay.
So that allowed us to get all the pieces together to build a real system. Mm-hmm.
So when do you expect, Nate, to have something that's actually cost effective then?
To get to that point, we still have some materials advances to do in order to simplify the manufacturing process.
So if I gave you 10 more years on this, how confident do you feel?
Oh, I'm very confident that if we had 10 more years at a program at a scale that really was focused on doing this technology demonstration and transition that we'd be able to do that.
But 10 years isn't really a terribly long time.
No,
so,
it isn't really.
We're really looking at a practical feasibility of having this alternative artificial fuel available.
And we need to be able to make sure that we've proven each step along the way so we can effectively get from here to there.
Now, do you have anything else to show us on this?
This
is your team.
I got people. And the people not only do all the work, but they're the ones that we inspire and train to take this problem over, because, of course, an energy problem is going to span generations. Right?
And these are young people.
And that's exactly the point. Because the energy problem spans generations, we need to be training these people who are going to inherit this energy infrastructure and be able to see through the change and to motivate them that this is a calling that they should do.
Now, Nate, I'm going to do a plug for you here, actually for Caltech. We need young people to go into science. We really need more to go into science. Look at these exciting things that are in store. We need the minds and the enthusiasm of people to do this. We've got the expertise. We've got the brilliant mentoring and benevolence of people like Nate Lewis. So, young people, knock down whatever you can to get to Caltech and other institutions that are doing this kind of research. Get in there and get into science. Science is really our greatest hope for improving the future. It really is. In everything you look at, whether it's humanities, whether it's physical items, all our steps of progress come from science, which is discovering all these wonderful things and applications for them. So get over there, knock on Caltech's door, bring those young people in.
You bet. And we can enable that and facilitate it, but we can't see it through. We need those young scientists who have the passion and energy to help solve the problems of the world, right? Which are poverty, which are disease, and which is energy, which you can argue is the most enabling technology that helps us solve all these other problems. Because if you don't have energy, you can't deliver medicines and vaccines to people. You can't refrigerate them. Clean energy is a use-inspired calling for our generation of scientists.
I'm glad you mentioned that term energy, Nate, because I come from economics and business management, and a lot of people need to learn or know that guess what money is? Money is stored energy. Mm-hmm. It is fuel. It's another form of exactly what Dr. Lewis and his team are working on. So all this ties together. This use of energy is the key of really everything, at least material, on where we're going. And science keeps making these discoveries to find practical ways for us to do better in the world. And also it makes humanities discoveries to find out how we can be more reasonable with one another. And science is reason-based. Mm-hmm. It is not wish-based.
Right.
It's reason-based. And it gives us the clearest path to make progress. And so Nate and people like him are really leading our tremendous journey here. And I feel like we're living in a very primitive time, actually, compared with where we are headed, really. Mm-hmm. But I feel privileged, Nate, to be able to communicate these strides that you're making to everybody.
Happy to do it.
So is there anything else you would like to add to this?
If we don't fix this energy problem in the one chance we have, because carbon dioxide lasts for thousands of years in our atmosphere, the world will never be the same. So we have a compelling clock to get all hands on deck and solve this energy problem in a sustainable way in the one chance that humanity has before nature does whatever it's going to do to us. And I want to be part of that solution.
Well, you made that point in the previous program about coral reefs, for example, that are being ruined by acidification, apparently, due to this CO2. And you actually told us, you know, you can track carbon dioxide that's human created. You know, I didn't know that you could do that, but you can do that.
Oh, absolutely.
So what we have here is the prospect of making these improvements. Heck, we're talking about terraforming Mars, you know, which involves polluting the Martian atmosphere and trapping gases in it and so on. If we're talking about that, we certainly are able to do something about our Earth, regardless of arguments people make about, well, did we cause this? There's all this proof you have that we're causing a lot of trouble. Regardless of what the source is, you're showing we can terraform Earth quite well if we really get on it. And this is one of the technologies
Absolutely.
That's doing it.
Absolutely.
So I wish you all the best.
Thank you.
Thank you very much,
You're welcome.
Sir.
Bye.